I'd like to call this meeting to order. Confirmation of the agenda that the Council of the Township of North Huron hereby accepts the agenda for May 17th, 2021 council meeting as presented. Do I have a mover? Sorry, do I have a mover?
I'll move that, Kevin.
Kevin moves it. Seconder is Nita Van Henderson. Carson, it's all yours.
Thank you, Your Worship. So Deputy Reeves Sipe?
Yes.
Counselor Falconer?
Yes.
Counselor Heffer?
Yes.
Counselor Van Henderson?
Yes.
Counselor Palmer?
Yes.
Counselor McBurney?
Yes.
And Reeve Bailey?
Yes.
So that motion carries 7-0.
Thank you. Disclosure of canary interest. I am going to declare one tonight for the in-camera meeting. I may or may not have a pecuniary interest, but for the sake of the council, I don't need to be there. Deputy Reeves Sipe will continue the meeting from that point on. Thank you. Public comments, opportunity for.
So Reeve Bailey, can you just, with that, can you just note the agenda number?
Oh, maybe I can. Has anybody got the number for the, oh, I'm not sure what's going on in the agenda for closed meeting. I didn't even bother going into it because I knew I wasn't going to be there.
Okay, so it's agenda item 14 then, just so it's on the record.
Thank you very kindly. 14 it is. Good to go. Public comments, opportunity for members of the public to speak to an item of business on the agenda. 2 minutes per person. Anybody out there wishing to speak to anything that's on the agenda? Now would be the time to unmute your mic and speak up. Not hearing any, we shall move on. Consent agenda that the Council of the Township of North Huron hereby adopts consent items 5.1.1 to 5.1.2. And further, the Council of the Township of North Huron hereby receives consent items 5.1.3 to 5.3.6 for information. Do I have a mover? I have Rick moving and I have Paul seconding. Before we take the roll call, is there anything anybody would like to pull out for that? Out of that, anything they'd like to talk to? I am not seeing anyone or hearing anyone speak out, so I'll give it over to you, Carson.
Thank you, Your Worship. So, Counselor Falconer?
Yes.
Counselor Heffer?
Yes.
Counselor Van Henderson?
Yes.
Counselor Palmer?
Yes.
Counselor McBurney?
Yes.
Deputy Reeves Sipe?
Yes.
And Reeve Bailey?
Yes.
So that motion carries 7-0.
Thank you. Public meetings, hearings, and delegations. Tonight we have Maitland Robert River Elementary School, Sacred Heart Catholic Elementary School, and F.E. Medill Secondary School. The Umbrella Project update, and I'm going to hand it over to that group right now if they'd like to present it to Angela.
Hello, everyone. My name is Angela Cowley, and I'm the principal of Maitland River Elementary School. I'm here tonight with colleagues Deanne Dielstra, the principal at F.E. Medill Secondary School, Dan Bodkin, the principal of Sacred Heart School, as well mental health leads from our schools are with us. Janice Shaw from Maitland River, Ann Gay, Lisa Jackson, and Shannon Mercer from F.E. Medill, and Dana Bozzotto, the mental health lead from the Huron-Perth Catholic District School Board. Ann Robinson, the mental health lead for the Avon-Maitland District School Board, and 3 student mental health leads from Maitland River, Amelia, Jasmine, and Addison. North Huron Council, thank you for this opportunity to share with you an important project that is taking place in schools located in North Huron, supporting and developing nearly 1,500 students' mental health and well-being. It is called the Umbrella Project. Margaret Mead says, never doubt that a small group of thoughtful, committed citizens can change the world. Indeed, it is the only thing that ever has. While we hope that ultimately our work does ripple further than we can even anticipate, our goal is to focus on strengthening the well-being of students and their families in North Huron through the Umbrella Project so that they are capable of dealing with the problems we face today. Our students are growing up in a complex world. There are many studies to explain why today's students and families are more stressed than ever. For example, social media is having a negative impact, global issues are more prevalent, and many family dynamics have negatively shifted. As a result, students present differently. We began working together because we were committed to responding to their needs. We were seeking common language. We added more and more people and organizations to our meetings, including the North Huron Children's Center, Mental Health Matters, the North Huron Family Health Team, the Health Unit, our board's mental health and addiction nurses, seeking their voices. Eventually, through this process, we were linked with the Wingham Community Connectors. We call ourselves the North Huron Wellbeing Committee, not to be confused with any work of the Township of North Huron. All the while, we were seeking a way of aligning ourselves, but we're struggling to find a way to do this well. Dan Dielstra learned of the Umbrella Project. It was the perfect fit, especially because it encourages the development of skills that we had identified as areas of deep need, resilience, and self-compassion. It is important to share that this project fits well with many of our mandates, but especially our safe schools work and our leading mentally healthy schools focus. Recently, we presented to the Human Community Connectors a few times. Two North Huron counselors sit on that committee. This is how we made our way to you today. They wanted us to share our work. Our hope is that the Umbrella Project can be spread further into our community. Dan Bodkin is now going to tell you about a video that we will share with you.
Thank you, Angela. A great job introducing the Umbrella Project. This is a short 2-minute video which will highlight what the Umbrella Project is, and I hope you enjoy it, and then I'll speak to it afterwards. Roll the video.
So this should play through the WebEx here, but just if it doesn't, if you guys can't hear it on your end, just speak up.
Throughout our lives, we are met with many challenges and setbacks. Much like the rain, these are aspects of our life that most people experience and we have little control over. Life isn't always sunny, and we spend a lot of energy wishing the storm clouds away instead of properly protecting ourselves from the rain overhead. The good news is we are all equipped with an umbrella. Some are big, some are small, others have holes, or have been forgotten in our closet. But everybody's got one. Our umbrella is made of emotional and cognitive skills like gratitude, empathy, grit, purpose, and many more. These skills are shared by the happiest and most successful people and can be highly predictive of future well-being. Through using our umbrella skills, we can actually strengthen our umbrella and start to reframe the challenges we experience, downgrading what felt like a tornado to a light drizzle. All of the skills are important and work best together. For example, working hard day after day with grit is great, but with no sense of purpose is unfulfilling. As our umbrella grows, healthy habits are important to provide the strength it takes to hold it up, especially when the big storms roll through. Using our umbrella gives us the confidence to actively pursue life's opportunities despite the weather. And after the rain, we may even find some puddles to play in. When we're young, we depend on umbrellas around us to provide protection. But as we grow and venture out on our own, we want to make sure we are using our own umbrella. Using your own umbrella is empowering. Relying on other people's umbrellas places our well-being in their hands. In really strong groups, everyone has their own umbrella. That way, when you need some extra shelter and support, there's lots to go around. Other people will use their umbrellas more just from watching us use ours. It's a ripple effect. The best way to teach the umbrella skills is to set an example by using your own.
Thanks, Carson, for playing that there. So the idea of the Umbrella Project is each month we study a different social and emotional and cognitive skill. So this month, for example, is integrity, and it's woven into, we talk about integrity. Our teachers teach it, have it in our announcements. Different schools in the Wingham do it in a different way. But the most important thing is each month we're learning a new social or cognitive skill, And we're doing this in the, we started before, I think, well, we started after Maitland River, but about 2019, we're in the middle of a once in 100-year pandemic. I can't think of a better time for us to be focusing on these social and emotional and cognitive skills. And you can see in the umbrella, grit, purpose, self-compassion, integrity, on and on. It takes 2 years to run through all of these different skills, and the students become stronger because, I mean, they have the language of social, emotional, and cognitive skills, but they also know how to use them and how to support one another. So I think in a nutshell, what it does is helps students and young people and people prepare for, you know, a rainy day. And the umbrella is a metaphor for that protection and preparing and anticipating bad weather. So in a nutshell, that's what the Umbrella Project is. Back to you. Angela, did you want me to introduce somebody else, or this is your office?
Janice just needed a minute to take it back from Carson because he had to play the video. We're now going to hear from one of the student mental health leads from Maitland River. You have to keep in mind that she is in grade 6. We have a K-6 school. In your agenda package, you would have got a self-assessment of your umbrella skills. So Amelia is a grade 6 student, is going to share hers.
Some of my areas of strength are grit and authenticity. I think they're my areas of strength. For example, grit. I'm a very stubborn person, and once I get fixated on doing something, I will do it till it's done. Authenticity is one of my areas of strength because I've come to like myself and be proud of my differences. One of my areas to improve is growth mindset. I don't like being wrong, and when I'm wrong, I will get very mad about it. Another one of my areas to improve is mindfulness. Instead of talking about my feelings, I hide them away, which isn't good. I think that's one of my areas to improve in. I hope you enjoyed hearing me talk my umbrella. Thank you.
Okay, and I think one of our students might have had trouble connecting tonight. Jasmine, are you here? Okay, so this is Jasmine's umbrella, her self-assessment. She just couldn't join us tonight. And now we're going to hear from the principal of FEMADIL, Deanne Dielstra.
Hello, everyone. Prior to my arrival at MADIL, the school community had experienced 3 student deaths by suicide, each separated by about a year. Mental health was on everyone's mind, and the goal was to advocate for additional support and counseling for students who might be struggling with mental health. Even having the additional supports in place, students were still self-identifying with very high levels of anxiety. Through our journey, this group realized the importance of being upstream, giving all students the skills to handle life stressors rather than waiting until students are overwhelmed and can't keep their head above water because the stream is just flowing too quickly. This is when we got involved in the Umbrella Project. We loved the umbrella metaphor and believed that the umbrella skills could be universally taught in our elementary and secondary schools. But teaching the umbrella skills needs to go beyond our 3 schools and into the community. In the past 2 years, MADIL has had 3 families lose a parent by suicide, and at least 2 other deaths by suicide have happened in the community that directly affected our students. Our delegation and all of the staff and students we represent realize that building these umbrella skills of well-being needs to be bigger than the school level. Representatives from this delegation presented at several meetings with the Wingham Community Connectors Group to pitch some ideas of how the Umbrella Project could come alive in the community. I will turn this over to Addison to share a few of the ideas before we do a closing.
Unfortunately, due to COVID-19, it has been hard to get other students' ideas about connecting the Umbrella Project to the community. but we still have some amazing ideas. So I'll be sharing a few. First, there is an umbrella campaign. Anyone can participate. All you have to do is put an umbrella on your yard to help build curiosity. You can also post it on social media. That's where hashtag comes in. A hashtag is a few words. It is also a link to more information on the project. Here are some we came up with. Hashtag we got you covered and hashtag let it rain. Another idea is going on the radio station. Someone could interview people on the Umbrella Project and it will help educate and grow interest on the project. Another great idea is doing a video about an umbrella skill and explaining what the skill is and how to use it. Signs and posters are a good way to promote this project. Businesses could put posters or signs in their windows to help promote. Another simple but great idea is a web page with all the information about the Umbrella Project and explains each skill. A storefront drop-in is another good idea that could help people learn about the Umbrella Project. Sidewalk chalk is a great way to spread positive messages and to brighten up people's day. A wisdom bracelet is a fun reminder about the umbrella skills. And a wisdom bracelet is a bracelet with a few positive reminders, and those are only a few of our amazing ideas.
Thanks, Addison. So in conclusion, our delegation of board mental health leads, administrators, staff, and students believe that having a common language regarding well-being skills is the first step in uniting us all in a common goal. Once individuals know the umbrella skills of well-being, we can work to help the residents of North Huron strengthen their umbrellas so we can better weather the storms together. Thanks so much for your time.
Thank you very kindly. I would just before we stop, I'm wondering, did the other student get a chance to get on board if she would still like to talk? Probably seen somebody join the meeting, Angela.
No, but thank you for considering that. But no, she didn't. She's having some sort of a technical issue.
I do see a Jasmine in here now, actually.
Oh, okay. Is that okay if we go back to her umbrella and she can share it?
Most certainly.
She can maybe talk about it. Maybe it's too hard to go into the video. Jazzy, you can do yours now, please.
Oh, we lost her.
Yes, her internet.
Yeah, she just disappeared from the meeting.
Yeah, poor thing. Her internet is just not reliable enough.
So unfortunate. Well, thank you. I want to thank
you. Thank
you. I want to thank you folks for coming out and sharing this with us. And I've already had a run at it. And my counselors probably already know the two that I need to work on. And anyway, we want to thank you very kindly. We want to thank the two counselors for being part of this. I believe it was Paul and Trevor, I believe, are part of this great idea. So if they had anything they wanted to say or any of the counselors would like to speak up, now would be a good time. Go ahead, Deputy Reeve Sipe.
Yeah, thank you, Reeve. You know, I think, you know, from in all honesty, I think this project, you know, is really an initiative that not only North Huron, but the county, you know, this is such an important thing in every community, not only during a 100-year pandemic, but just in a normal life. Like, the life that we live today is not the same life that we had 25 years ago or 30 years ago. The stresses of life are a lot different, and how we deal with those stresses, and how, you know, the part of this that I really enjoy that I'm listening to is students of an elementary level, you know, knowing about themselves, being self-aware about where they are in their mental health, so that when they become an older, you know, when I was grade six, I didn't know half of what these children know today. And I, you know, I think ultimately that's a kudos to the system on how we're dealing with, you know, mental health and mental support today that we didn't do back, you know, when I was in public school, many years ago. So, No, I really appreciate the fact of them having self-awareness, but ultimately these tools are not just for children. These tools are for adults. These tools are for, you know, everybody that's on this meeting to help understand their being them self-aware about where they need support and need help, and how going forward, I think, you know, getting the community involved on knowledge about this program is only going to help people resonate about what they need support in, how do we get that support to them, and as a community, how we can grow this project to be even more of not only in a school atmosphere, but in a community atmosphere. So I appreciate you allowing me to have that couple of minutes to talk, but I really do want to say thank you again to the group that participated here tonight, because I think it's an important project for the community, not only North Huron, but Huron County.
Thank you very much, Deputy Sipes. Councillor Heffer?
Thank you, Reeve. I just want to thank Amelia, Addison, and Jasmine for your talk. It takes bravery to do that. I go back a few years since I was back in grade 6. I know that a couple more maybe than Mr. Sipes, but I know people are going to be watching you, and I know you people are all the time setting an example, and I really appreciate that. And I know your moms and dads can be proud of you, and just as you continue to grow this project, it's very much appreciated by older grandparents, I guess you could say, that it really makes us happy. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Heffer. Anyone else? Not seeing any hands. Thank you very much for that, folks. And we will move on now. Clerk's Department 7.1.1, Consent Application for King. Consent Application Report, file number C35-21. Owner applicant, Leota Mary King and Michael Connell, Siskins LLP. Property description, lot 25, plan 430, Wingham Town. Ship of North Huron, 143 Boland Street. That the Council of the Township of North Huron hereby recommends approval of the consent application file number C35-21, owner applicant Leota Maria King and Michael Connell, Siskins LLP, property description lot 25, plan 430 Wingham Town, Ship of North Huron, 143 Boland Street, with the conditions set out in the Huron County Planning and Development Report presented by Monica Bolton, Walker Bolton, at the May 17th, 2021 council meeting. Let me take a mover. No, does Monica want to speak to this tonight, Carson, or you?
Yes, Monica has a report, Your Worship.
Thank you kindly, Monica, if you don't mind.
Good evening, Reeve Bailey and council. I do have a PowerPoint presentation. I just need to get that queued up here for you. Okay, this is consent application number 35 for 2021. The location of the property is 143 Boland Street, and that's legally described as lot 25, plan 430 Wingham in the township of North Huron. The purpose of the proposed severance is to enlarge an abutting property. The area to be severed is very small in area, only 27 square meters or 0.007 of an acre. The lands are designated residential in the township's official plan and zoned R1 residential low density. The area retained, the area that will be left behind after the severance, is 783 square meters or 0.2 acres, and it contains a single detached residence dwelling and a shed. That property is designated residential and is zoned R1 residential low density. So on this slide, you can see the small area of the severance. It's along Catherine Street. It's enlarging a lot that's abutting on Catherine Street. And the subject property's address is on Boland Street. So this sliver of land at the back of the property on Boland Street will be added to the abutting property on Catherine Street. You can see on this plan that was provided by the applicant that there is a garage that has a eave that encroaches a little bit into the Boland Street property. The purpose of the severance is to correct the lot lines so that the garage and the eave of that garage property on Catherine Street will be completely on its own property and not encroaching into an abutting property. So this air photo shows the story a little bit better. This is the area outlined in orange is the subject property. The severance is coming off of the back of the Boland Street property and is being added to the abutting Catherine Street property. In reviewing this application, the planning department has considered the policies of the provincial policy statement, the township official plan, and it is recommended that this application for severance be recommended for approval with the recommended conditions. And those would be my comments for now, but I'm available if there's any questions.
Thank you very kindly. I think I'll get a mover and seconder before we go into questions. We'll just wait till we have the full screen back up.
Sorry, I think I need to stop sharing, but I need to.
Thank you. Chris, move.
Reeve, I'll move it.
Chris is moving. Seconder, please. Paul Heffer is seconding. Any questions, comments, or concerns from council? Not seeing or hearing anything. I'm going to hand it over to you, Carl. Oh, sorry. Chris Palmer has a question.
Yeah, just wondering. It says that there were no comments at the time. Has there been any comments since, say from the neighbor?
No, we haven't received any further comments.
Okay.
Any other questions? Not seeing any, I'm going to hand it over to you, Carson.
Thank you, Your Worship. So the motion on the floor is that the Council of the Township of North Huron hereby recommend approval of the consent application file C-3521, owner applicant Leota Marie King and agent Michael Cannell. Property description, lot 25, plan 430 Wingham, Township of North Huron, 143 Boland Street, with the conditions set out in the Huron County Planning and Development Report presented by Monica Walker Bolton at the May 17th, 2021 council meeting. So, Councillor Heffer?
Yes.
Councillor Van Henderson?
Yes.
Councillor Palmer?
Yes.
Councillor McBurney?
Yes.
Deputy Reeve Seid?
Yes.
Councillor Falconer?
Yes.
And Reeve Bailey?
Yes.
So that motion carries 7-0.
Thank you. 7.1.2 would be plan 2021-17 site plan control agreement with the Blythe Festival. Location, part of the lot 42, concession 1, plan 173, block M Blythe, Township of North Huron, 377 Gypsy Lane. Owner, applicant, Township of North Huron and the Blythe Festival. That the Council of the Township of North Huron hereby approves the Blythe Festival proposed development as it applies to part of lot 42, concession 1, plan 173, block M Blythe, Township of North Huron, 377 Gypsy Lane. And further, that the council deems the adoption of the bylaw number 42-2021 to be time sensitive and approves the extension of section 19.1 of the procedure bylaw, allowing for bylaw number 42-2021 to be adopted at the May 17th, 2021 regular meeting. Monica, did you want to speak to this one too?
Sorry, this is the Blythe site plan?
Yes.
Yes, I do have a presentation for that.
Thank you.
I'll share that. So this is a presentation for the site plan application for the Blythe Festival. The application is for an outdoor performance venue. The current zoning is CF-1 community facility special zones. The land use designation in the township's official plan is community facility. Drawings have been submitted and reviewed by the township's development review team. The area of the subject property, this is the township owned campground property, is outlined in black on this slide. So that's the area where the proposed development will be located. And this is the site plan that was provided by the Blythe Festival. So the purpose is to create an outdoor performance stage for the Blythe Festival in response to the increased physical distancing and need for fresh air performance area that has arisen from COVID-19. The hope is that the Blythe Festival will be able to put on their season with this outdoor venue. In reviewing this application, the comments were reviewed from the development team and review was provided by our department, planning and development. The considerations that planning and development gave in our review was review of conformity with the township's zoning bylaw, conformity with the site plan control bylaw, and consideration of the accessible site plan accessibility guideline that was published by Huron County in 2016. So in review of all of those considerations, the planning department has no concerns with the proposed application, although we recommended that this application be reviewed by the Huron County Accessibility Committee because it is a public lands. It's a venue being operated on township owned lands and open to the public. But at this time, the planning and development department has no concerns, and we feel that the application for site plan can be approved and that any concerns or comments that might be identified by the site plan accessibility advisory committee can be incorporated at later approval stages. So those would be my comments at this time, and I'm available if there are any questions.
Thank you very much. I think I'll get a mover and seconder before we have a conversation. Can I get a mover? I have Mr. Faulkner moving. Do I have a seconder? I have Mr. McBurney seconding. I'm going to open it up now for council's comments, concerns, questions. No, go ahead, Mr. Palmer.
Thank you, Reeve, and through you to Monica. You mentioned that this is their game plan for this year. You know, thinking that everything's going to kind of stay as it is, status quo. Do they have plans for beyond this year when everyone expects that life should be more or less normal? Will they still, you know, have uses for it? Simple as that.
Thank you very much, Chris. With Monica.
Through the Reeve, I would maybe ask that the folks that are on the call from the Blythe Festival respond to that question.
Hey, Gil, you seem to have your hands full, but if you got a minute.
I do indeed have my hands full. I just brought the baby for pity. So you can all feel for us. yeah, we'll work on building the daycare next. The main thing I wanted to say was we are planning for the next 5 years. I mean, we're hoping to have shows that will happen on the outdoor stage, both this coming summer, this current summer, and then with the lease agreement that we signed with the township was for 5 years. So our hope is to continue to grow and expand and build and use that this facility for years to come. And also one thing we have begun conversations with is also how we can share this facility, because there is no parallel facility anywhere in the county, how we can share it with other groups. So we've been talking, for instance, to the Threshers and saying, you know, how could this be useful to the Threshers? Could you have the fiddle contest on it? Could you have some of the concerts happening on it? You know, what could the programming look like there? Maybe it's not this year, maybe next year they'll be able to really animate it. Also, we talked to them about, you know, what plays could Blythe Festival put on during the Threshers event that might complement the Threshers event, that could be an opportunity for us to work together to entertain people and keep them excited. I also did talk in 2020, just before Christmas, with the folks from the Barn Dance Society who had canceled their farewell concert last year, in the hopes of saying, hey, maybe here's an opportunity for the Barn Dance to come back on stage, to have a venue in Blythe that they could play outdoors. So I think we're really just starting to wade out that way. We also had a conversation with one of the board chairs and the executive director for the Huron Waves Festival. And I also leaned over the pharmacy counter to talk to the executive director from the Celtic Festival, who they've also been looking for venues out and around. And so I think it really has the potential to not only serve the Blythe Festival beautifully, but to also serve the community more broadly and bring even more programming opportunities to the town. And that's our hope. I mean, I would say just one other thing, like over the last 47 years, what the township has done for the Blythe Festival has been truly incredible. I mean, and we wouldn't be here if we had not had the support of the township all of these years. And we have tried wherever possible to give back, whether it is our care and custody of Memorial Hall, or whether it is, you know, the tens of thousands of tourists coming through town every year. And in this situation, I think here's an opportunity for Blythe Festival and our members and supporters to build what could be a real beautiful legacy project in town that could help to continue to build the momentum, not only for our operations, but also for the vibrant culture hub that Blythe, Ontario, incredibly enough, has proved itself to be.
Thank you very much, Gil. So
the answer is yes.
A long yes. Thank you very much. Go ahead, Chris.
Yeah, I do have a follow-up question, if that's all right, through you, Reeve, to Gil. Is there a way of protecting the asset? Like, it looks, I really like the design here. It looks good. I just hope that it doesn't get ruined.
Yes. Thank you for that question. It is something that we've been talking about quite a bit. And actually, we have at this point already designed some deterrent pieces that will attach to kind of the scaffolding that you see on there. So these deterrent pieces will be there to prevent people from, for instance, getting on to the second tier of it. And we've also been talking about some other security options that we could have out there, everything from whether we need a camera or lights or whatever those would be. I don't know if Rachel, if you want to add anything to that. Plus Rachel will be camping out there every night. There you go.
Yeah. just that it is an ongoing and evolving conversation of identifying what's out there and how we best keep it safe, both in season as well as out of season. Once, you know, once it shuts down for the fall, for example, what does that look like related to snow and snowmobilers and all that kind of thing as well?
Thank you very much. Any other counselors, questions, comments, or concerns? Go ahead, Deputy Reeve-Sight.
Yes, thank you, Reeve. I don't have any concerns from the layout from what was. Obviously, it is a grander outlay than what I was first envisioning, obviously, from when it was came to council a couple times or a little bit while back, which I'm not against in the sense that the Blythe Festival has always been go big or go home. and they're going big, and I'm not against going big. What I am concerned about is I see parking spaces. I'm concerned about number versus traffic flow, and what does that all look like? And maybe that's not for tonight's discussion, but I'm a little concerned about, I don't know what the, in my head, I can't understand the capacity of the seating versus how many parking spots there is, and how does that resonate in the town and traffic and a whole bunch of other things. So maybe that's not the conversation for tonight, but I mean, it just was a comment or question of my position, just looking at the, you know, the drawing and seeing, you know, how somebody would overlay that plan. So I don't know if that's a discussion or somebody wants to comment about that tonight, but I mean, I'm not concerned otherwise. You know, parking's been an issue for the Blythe Festival, regardless of where it's held. So I'm not suggesting this is any different.
Thank you very much, Deputy Sipes. Abdiel, if you wanted to bring that back for a presentation another night, or did you want to address that tonight? No, it's going to come back.
Oh, Rachel, do you want to speak to it for a second?
Yeah, I can speak to it. Sure. So the majority of the parking will be at the actual arena parking lot, and that the parking spots that you see there are specifically related to mobility concerns and those who it's not possible to drop off and have the car go park otherwise. So those are just spots for like accessible parking at this point.
Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Not go ahead, Kevin Falker.
Yeah, through you, Bernie. To Gil, how are you gonna keep the pigeons from flying away?
Well, you know, we're gonna train them artfully. That'll be it. So yeah. Make sure we get lots of rollers and tumblers up there. It'll be real entertaining.
Anyone else? Not seeing any? I'd just like to say, been a bit of part of this is from the concept that I am truly excited, and I was surprised and very happy that the go big or go home attitude was taken. I'm totally looking forward to seeing this come to fruition. I know my counselors are, and we will work with you every step of the way, and we will be there in any way we can. As you know, we have COVID-19 hanging over our heads and financial situations. We truly, truly look forward to continuing this great thing that the Blythe Festival does. I'm going to now hand it over to Carson for roll call.
Thank you, Your Worship. So the motion on the floor is that the Council of the Township of North Huron hereby approves the Blythe Festival proposed development as it applies to part of Lot 42, Concession 1, Plan 173, Block M, Blythe, Township of North Huron, 377 Gypsy Lane. And further, that Council deems the adoption of bylaw number 42/2021 to be time sensitive and approves an exception to section 19.1 of the procedure bylaw, allowing bylaw number 42/2021 to be adopted at the May 17th, 2021 regular meeting. So, Councillor Van Hiddersen?
Yes.
Councillor Palmer?
Yes.
Councillor McBurney?
Yes.
Deputy Reeve Sipes?
Yes.
Councillor Falconer?
Oh, yes.
Councillor Heffer?
Yes.
And Reeve Bailey?
Yes.
So that motion carries 7-0.
Thank you very kindly. We shall move on now to 7.1.3, the 2021-10 OPP Detachment Board Proposal Update. That the Council of the Township of North Huron hereby receives a report from the clerk dated May 17, 2021 regarding the OPP Detachment Board Proposal Update for information purposes. And further, that the Council requests that the Township of North Huron have an elected official as a voting member on the new Huron OPP Board Detachment. And further, that the Chief Administrating Officer be directed to forward this resolution to the Huron County Lower Tier Municipal Working Group for the purpose of developing an OPP Detachment Board proposal for the Huron OPP Detachment to be submitted to the Ministry of the Solicitor General. I'm going to ask for a mover and seconder, and then maybe Dwayne would like to talk to us, or actually maybe Deputy Reeve Sipes might. Can I get a mover? I have Deputy Reeve Sipes moving, and I have Kevin Faulkner seconding. Did you want to talk to this, Dwayne? Who wants to talk to this?
It's up to Deputy Reeve Sipe. I can if you wish, or if you wish to speak to it.
Yeah, I can just let council know what's going on. Obviously, based on the proposal from the Solicitor General, the new Police Services Act that is going to be hopefully, or at least the anticipation is going to be in arrangement by the spring of 2022, is that they are anticipating an OPP detachment board as opposed to our current police services board as we read today. So what that is in basically intended is a board for all of Huron County that would be basically it would replace all the current section 5.1, section 10 boards, and allow representation for all the paid places that have a section 5.1 if they wish. So really ultimately what the plan has been right now is the CAO groups have come together looking for some suggestion about what the makeup of this board may look like. Obviously based on the legislation is basically indicating that every community who is represented in that detachment is able to have able to have representation on that board, unless they deem that they don't want it. So what's happened is that right now, obviously in the lower tier, we have 9 municipalities. What the group is asking for ultimately is, do you want to have a representative on this board or not? Because if you want a representative on this board, that is now then going to determine the other parts of the board, because the other part of the legislation says 20% of the board has to be community representatives and 20% of the board needs to be provincial appointees. So until we understand, until the CAO group gets all the information back from each individual respective councils, we can't make a determination about what size this board is going to be and then send in a proposal to the OPP in order to get somewhat of approval or direction from the Solicitor General that we're okay to proceed as we're going. I don't think I missed that. That's really what this request is for. Ultimately, it gives obviously groups like, in our particular case, the group of Blythe and East Wallmash being a 5.1, they're still going to have representation through our council elected representative, no different than they would technically have today on how I see our board being implemented in this particular case. Is there any other questions of council that, if I didn't explain it or was a little more than what was there, but I don't think I missed anything. Dwayne, Carson, do you think I missed anything?
I think you covered it well, but happy to answer any questions.
Go ahead, Mr. Falcon.
Through your reef to Deputy Reeve-Sipe. With the changing of the board format, that's not indicative of changing any of the detachment areas. Paul, it's just going to be the way it was. It's just strictly with the board. They're not trying to restructure zones.
Okay, no, the restructuring, it's an OPP. So that instead of it being, North Huron having their board, South Huron having their board, they're basically saying it's the Huron OPP. You are going to have one board for the entire catchment area is what they're doing. That's all they're doing.
Okay.
Anyone else? Not? Go ahead, Councillor Palmer.
Yeah, through you, Reeve, to maybe Dwayne or to the Deputy Reeve. It's regarding the financial impact. I know what it says. I can read it, but they don't know. Will all municipalities be charged whether they're participating or not? Or, I'd love to have more information if it was available.
So I can answer that, Dwayne. Mm-hmm. Councillor Palmer, you're absolutely correct in the sense that the board composition and what this is going to look like financially has not been really well communicated by the Solicitor General. Like, they have not given any indication about what is required from a costing perspective. They've only said is that there's going to be provincial appointees that have to be paid for. There's going to have to be mandatory training that's being done that has to be done. But they have not said every catchment area is required to compensate for whatever. They've not indicated any of that. What that is, the discussion is going to be going back after the composition has been done and the CAOs get into this, and with elected officials who are on this chair. Like, we've got other board members, other police service board members who are on this committee as well, determining what that's going to look like. So, I can use my opinion as my sense is that I don't see that just because you don't have representation on the board, do you get out scot-free? I don't think you should. I think you're going to have representation depending on whether you want to exercise that representation by the member who sits on the board for you. I'm only one opinion. So, that's going to be the stuff that's going to be feathered out between this community group or this group that's going to be dealing with this police services board composition. But I would argue that what I will say is I would not anticipate North Huron's price cost for a police services board be going up. It should not go up because of this discussion.
Thank you very much. Go ahead, Dwayne.
And through you, Reeve, I'll maybe just add in terms of the province, there's still regulations for the province to develop and pass yet. So just adding to Deputy Reeve Sipes' comments that as Councillor Palmer has identified in terms of there's still unknowns. And during the CAO working group, that was flagged. I mean, we're working on what we know today. So
it's really hard to pass something with this, where it's the big hope thing. So, I'd hate to see it 50 grand, it's really hard, but okay, we'll have to have some faith.
The one thing is that here's the negative, Councillor Palmer, is that there is really no not approving it. The province is going to mandate it. So that's what the regulation is going to indicate. They're going to indicate under the Police Services Act that there is only going to be one board in Huron County. So do you want, basically all this community group is, or this working group is asking at the current time of this council is, do you want a representative or not?
Yeah, all right.
The information that's going to be like your questions and your issues about where the money's coming from and who's paying for what, that's going to be all fished through and sent back to councils to get some approval, because all the councils that have a seat on this board are going to have to agree to what this allocation split and discussion is going to be.
You're right. I was overthinking this.
Thank you very kindly. Okay. I believe on this one, I do have a mover and a seconder. So I'll hand it over to Carson.
Thank you, Your Worship. So the motion on the floor is that the Council of the Township of North Huron hereby receives the report of the clerk dated May 17th, 2021 regarding the OPP Detachment Board proposal update for information purposes, and further that Council requests that the Township of North Huron have an elected official as a voting member on the new Huron OPP Detachment Board, and further that the Chief Administrative Officer be directed to forward this resolution to the Huron County Lower Tier Municipal Working Group for the purpose of developing an OPP Detachment Board proposal for the Huron OPP Detachment to be submitted to the Ministry of the Solicitor General. So, Councillor Palmer?
Yes.
Councillor McBurney?
Yes.
Deputy Reeve Sipe?
Yes.
Councillor Falconer?
Yes.
Councillor Heffer?
Yes.
Councillor Van Hiddersen?
Yes.
And Reeve Bailey?
Yes.
So that motion carries 7-0.
Thank you. 7.1.4 would be the CL-2021-11 Internet Design and Training Project Proposal. That the Council of the Township of North Huron hereby receives the report from the clerk dated May 17, 2021 regarding the Internet Design and Training Program Proposal for information purposes. And further, that the Council accepts the Internet Design and Training Project Proposal in the amount of $4,300 from Epic Studios Inc. for the design, setup, and training of the new township internet for staff. And further, that the council authorizes for the internet design and training project to be paid paid for using the 2021 provincial COVID-19 relief funding. And further, that the council authorizes the director of finances to make the necessary changes to the 2021 budget to allow for the project to be funded through the 2021 provincial COVID-19 relief funding. And further, the council directs the clerk to bring forward the necessary bylaw and agreement for the June 7th, 2021 regular meeting to enter into an agreement with Epic Studios Inc. for the design, setup, and training of the new township internet for staff. I'm going to get a mover and seconder, then I believe Carson's probably going to speak to this one. Do I have a mover, please? I have Anita Van Henderson moving, and I have Deputy Reeve Sipes seconding. Carson, did you want to speak to this, or Dwayne, which is which?
Yeah, it would be me, Your Worship. So not much to add, but beyond what was in the report, but spurring this forward is certainly the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic and the need for department heads and staff to communicate with all staff, some of whom don't have North Huron email addresses, as well as the new human resources policy manual that is anticipated to be rolled out shortly. So for council's benefit, an intranet is basically an internal secure network that North Huron has used in the past to communicate with staff. So for example, we would post our health and safety policies, our human resources policies, internal documents that all staff need access to, even though they don't have a North Huron email address. In the past, North Huron used a server-based intranet, and so you had to be physically located on, you had to be able to access the server in order to access the data. However, this hasn't been updated in a few years due to staffing changes, and it was ultimately retired when that server needed to be retired. So myself and the receptionist administrative assistant, we met with Continuit and Aptic Studios to kind of see what our options were to move something like this forward, knowing the time sensitivity as we continue to push towards moving forward with the new HR policy manual rollout. And kind of the consensus was that we should use a cloud-based intranet, such as something we can use through Office 365, where we can purchase SharePoint, and then it doesn't have to be server-based anymore. But we as SMT, we really wanted to see this used in more of a meaningful way than it had been used in the past. So attached to my report, you would have saw the intranet sitemap that we as department heads have pulled together. And as you'll see, we've developed this in a way where it will be constantly updated and constantly full of new information to keep all of our staff informed, regardless of whether they have a North Huron email address and regardless of whether they have access to our shared drives. So for example, you'll see on there, council highlights, a corporate strategy section, staff shout outs, but you'll also see important materials such as where to go for your new employee information package for onboarding of new employees, the frequently requested forms that you as a staff member will need, such as how to complete your expense reports, how to fill out your timesheets, that kind of thing. And also just vital documents to the organization, such as your health and safety program, your human resource policy, our fire safety plans for all the various buildings, and any required training that we're required to provide to all of our staff, such as WMIS, for example. We also have some departmental pages as well for each department, which we're hoping will allow more buy-in from all of our staff. and as well as a connect section such as internal job postings, community volunteer opportunities going on, as well as any North Huron based events. So we're really looking to flush this out further so that it becomes a meaningful resource for our staff, so that they're constantly informed of what's going on with council, what's going on throughout the organization. And we're also hoping that it creates some efficiencies as well. Now that we're recommending to move to a cloud-based system, because for example, we're able to put on, each end user is able to put on automatic notifications, right? So say if they want to be informed of a community event, if they turn on automatic notifications, it'll say, this is what's going on. Or say we've updated our, council has updated the human resources policy. When we upload something to the human resources policy, it will inform them that changes are made. And then they can ask their department head, oh, what is this change about? What does this mean for me as an employee of the organization? So that's really the intention of it. At this time, I'm seeking council's authorization to proceed with engaging Aptic Studios for this. So this is certainly a company that is familiar with town or municipal intranet systems. Recently, they have developed the municipality of Kincardine's intranet, and then right now they're working on the town of Goderich's intranet. So we were privy to those designs as well, and we were able to kind of incorporate that in our design. So at this time, we're seeking that direction to proceed with that. As council will be aware, this wasn't a budgeted project, but seeing as this has really been spurred ahead by COVID-19 and the importance of being able to communicate with all staff as we continue to change and reevaluate as an emergency operations control group, it would certainly be eligible for the COVID-19 relief funding we received in 2021. And just as council's aware, there's $41,669 that we received in 2021 for COVID-19 related expenses to be used during the ongoing COVID-19 pandemic. So no further things to add at this time, but certainly able to answer questions if there is any.
Thank you very kindly. I believe I do have a mover and a seconder, so I will go to council questions, councilor questions. Does anybody have, go ahead, Deputy Reeve Sipe. You're muted, Trevor.
Sorry, thank you, Reeve, sorry about that. Person, can you, is this going to have the ability to submit, are employees going to have the ability to submit electronically documents to their prospective, department heads or finance or wherever the case may be, as opposed to the printing and handing it to those delegated resources? I'm sensing that I'm not seeing if that is the case, but I guess that was my question. Is that something that's intuitive of this design?
So through your worship to Deputy Reeve Sipe. So for example, like in regard to expense forms or timesheets, is that kind of what you would take? So from a logistics perspective, basically this provides access to everyone in the organization. So you wouldn't really want your expense forms and your timesheets that require to go through the approvals process to be provided to everyone within the organization. But overall from, I'm certainly the director of finance would be able to speak to this better than I would, but in large part, we have moved towards a reduction in paper for sure. Like I know for like all the clerk's department timesheets, we do all those electronically, similar to how we do council expense sheets. They're all provided electronically now to myself too, right? So certainly not the intention of this. This is more of a resource sharing, secure network for all staff to have the resources they need throughout the organization, but that's kind of the intention at this point.
Okay. Thank you. Other questions or comments? Go ahead, Councilor Palmer.
After you, Reeve, to Carson. Yeah, you just touched the word security. I was just wondering if this affects the security of the system at all.
So through your worship to Councillor Palmer. So Continued IT certainly was involved in this process heavily, and nothing was raised in regard to security concerns. And so when this is set up, we will have administrators to the SharePoint system as well. So for example, if I'm an administrator, I can see who all has access. When an employee leaves the organization, the administrator has the ability to remove that individual's access to the documents within the SharePoint system.
Thank you very much, Carson. Any other questions? So this is just going to simplify, from my understanding, it's going to simplify things. So when the Reeve calls one of the department heads and it involves two other ones, we can get together faster on a subject. Would I be right on that?
So not necessarily, Your Worship. So this is, so we have a number of employees that, so for example, like our volunteer firefighters, some of our part-time staff, they don't have access to the shared drives where for example, the health and safety policies or the human resources documents or COVID-19 updates might be stored on the server. And because they don't have access to the shared drive and they don't have North Huron emails, which every time you add a new North Huron email, that's an additional expense incurred. So this is a way for us to communicate better with all staff throughout the organization so that they can all access the documents they need, particularly as we roll out the human resources policy, because there's going to be, depending on the approvals of that, based in its draft form, as council's aware, there's certainly numerous changes that would be recommended. And as that continues to be implemented, we want all our staff, regardless of whether they have a North Huron email address, to certainly be provided those documents, as well as other important documents within the organization.
Thank you very much, Carson. Any other questions? Not seeing any, I'm going to hand it right back to you, Carson.
Thank you, Your Worship. So the motion on the floor is that the Council of the Township of North Huron hereby receives the report of the clerk dated May 17, 2021 regarding the intranet design and training project proposal for information purposes, and further that council accepts the intranet design and training project proposal in the amount of $4,300 from Aptic Studios Inc. for the design, setup, and training of a new township intranet for staff. And further that council authorizes for the intranet design and training project to be paid for using the 2021 provincial COVID-19 relief funding, and further that council authorizes the director of finance to make the necessary changes to the 2021 budget to allow for the project to be funded through the 2021 provincial COVID-19 relief funding, and further that council directs the clerk to bring forward the necessary bylaw and agreement for the June 7th, 2021 regular meeting to enter into an agreement with Aptic Studios Inc. for the design, setup, and training of a new township intranet for staff. So, Councillor McBurney?
Yes.
Deputy Reeve-Site?
Yes.
Councillor Falconer?
Yes.
Councillor Heffer?
Yes.
Councillor Van Hittersen?
Yes.
Councillor Palmer?
Yes.
And Reeve Bailey?
Yes.
So that motion carries 7-0.
Thank you. 7.1.5 is the Indigenous Land Acknowledgement Statement and Policy. That the Council of the Township of North Huron hereby receives the report of the clerk dated May 17, 2021 regarding the Indigenous Land Acknowledgement Statement and Policy for information purposes. And further, the council hereby approves the Township of North Huron Indigenous Land Acknowledgement Policy as presented. And further, the council directs the clerk to prepare a bylaw to adopt the Township of North Huron Indigenous Land Acknowledgement Policy for the June 7th, 2021 regular council meeting. I'm going to get a mover and seconder, and then we'll have, I've got Kevin Falconer moving. Seconder, please. Seconder, please. I have Deputy Reeve-Site. Thank you very much. I'm going to hand it over to Carson to speak to this, I believe.
Yes, thank you, Your Worship. So, as council will have seen in the report, this stems from direction provided by the previous council in 2018. So this started in March of 2018 and continued into September of 2018 for the development of a plausible land acknowledgement statement for North Huron. So while I wasn't here at the time, my understanding is that there was the municipal election, some new council took office, as well as barriers that were encountered in the research and consultation process in the development of this plan. And we as staff continued that on to carry out the direction provided. And so in order to adopt a traditional land acknowledgement statement, you certainly want to consult with the relevant indigenous communities. And so we as staff undertook that consultation process, and we reached out to Kettle and Stony Point First Nation, as well as Saugeen Ojibwe Nation. And while we weren't able to make contact with Kettle and Stony Point, which I believe is the initial barrier that was encountered in 2018 as well, we were able to receive some feedback from Saugeen Ojibwe Nation. And so four statements were drafted, and Saugeen Ojibwe Nation provided a review and comment on those four. And there was two statements that they deemed, while all four of them were certainly appropriate and would be considered sufficient, there were two that were certainly their recommended options, and those were noted in both the staff report as well as the draft policy that was attached to the report. So at this time, we're seeking council direction as to whether this is still something council wants to proceed with. And basically the attached to the report was a policy which guides how the land acknowledgement statements can be implemented in North Huron as a fixture for North Huron. So for example, the policy recommends that use of the either of the policy statements are encouraged kind of at the beginning of council meetings, regular special council meetings, and even committees and boards, for example. So when the Reeve calls to order, he can certainly read either of those land acknowledgement statements, as well as incorporating it at the beginning of our corporate documents, such as our strategic plans, our official plan, relevant corporate document that we may develop over time, as well as in special events hosted by the municipality, right? So certainly the Reeve or any member of council, if attending a ceremony at a special event, can certainly kick off that special event by using one of the approved land acknowledgement statements. So there's certainly no financial impact to doing so. And at this time, we're seeking council's feedback as to whether that is something that still wants to be pursued by this council.
Thank you very much, Carson. I'm going to open it up to council questions, comments, or concerns. Go ahead, Kevin.
Thank you, Reeve. Yes, without the two treaties that we that are involved in our lands, I think it's Treaty 49 and I can't think of the other, the first one, but none of us would be here. We wouldn't have the ability to live and prosper in this land, and it's because of their stewardship that they through the treaties that we gained from the First Nations. I'm fully committed to the land acknowledgement. We've used it in the, I've mostly had it in the theater here for a couple of years, and I know that the at least the church that I attend to in town here, they open every meeting with it, and it's just it's a small little statement that would mean so much to the indigenous people of our areas, and I fully put my support behind any of the land acknowledgements being used to, with our meetings and any of the special meetings, because as I said when I started, we would not have the enjoyment of this beautiful part of the country that we call North Huron if it wasn't for the indigenous peoples that were the original landowners of this place.
Thank you very much, Mr. Falker. Anyone else like to speak to it? Go ahead, Mr. Palmer.
Thank you, Reeve. I don't want to get into a battle here, but just look at history around the world. We would be here. It would have just, the British were very good and sensible by forming treaties. In the States, they didn't. So anyhow, take note that the indigenous people gave thanks to their creator before they gathered. I think that's wonderful. We don't. But instead, we're expected to pay homage to the indigenous peoples that do. That doesn't work for me. I'll remind you that we don't give thanks to our wonderful country by singing O Canada. We don't give thanks to our queen, who incidentally owns over 90% of the landmass in Canada, by singing God Save the Queen, like we used to do those things. We don't give thanks to God, our creator, by praying before meetings. We only give thanks to the millions of soldiers that gave their lives during the different wars for our freedom. And that only happens once a year. Regarding the scope of this request, I will not pay homage to any particular group of people. Because it comes really, like looking at these two, especially the second one, it is almost equating to prayer. And prayer exists only to thank God. This is the way I believe. This request separates peoples. It divides peoples. This is not a healthy practice in a society that's struggling to have a unity. And, you know, I believe that everybody is equal, and you know, so this changes the ball game. And you know, I would say no to this motion.
Thank you, Councillor Palmer. Any other councillors like to speak to it? Deputy Reeve Sipe.
Yes, thank you, Reeve. I do want to make note, just knowledge of the part of this as the only elective official that remains from this original request. Really, this request bared every acknowledgement to the fact of reconciliation. The federal government has talked about reconciliation. Provincial governments have talked about reconciliation. You know, municipalities, whether it be North Huron or whoever, talk about reconciliation as well. So I, you know, as I respect everybody's opinion on where they want to have you know, provide their acknowledgement or lack thereof, that really is the content of where this came from. It really wasn't to, it really was not meant to make anybody specific in nature. It was really a discussion about reconciliation. That is what Councillor Vaughan had mentioned at the time of when he made this motion. And that is one of the reasons why I seconded it at that time and voted for in favor of at least having this discussion for whatever council was going to take to look at this. So I really do want to accept that, you know, I respect everybody's opinion of where they wish to do with this land acknowledgement policy. I just wanted to make sure and put context to the request at the time of when the request was asked by the previous council.
Go ahead, Councillor Hepper.
You, Rafe. Yes, I just noticed in the report, it says when the land acknowledgement is given, opportunity for the North Huron Council and staff, and here's what it says, reflect, be present, to pause, and to consider the impact and change in their work. Well, I sort of take offense to that. I feel that we're already coming here with our doing our due diligence homework here. And to start off with, it looked like when Mr. Vaughan went the Stony and Kettle Point people, they didn't get back to them. So why would they go up into Bruce County? Is I don't understand, but I cannot give support to this at all. Thank you.
Anyone else? Well, I'm going to speak to it. I think it's a wonderful idea. I think it's well overdue. I think acknowledging the past, but not living in it, but being happy that we are here because of the way the past turned out, and the fact that the Indigenous people and the rest of us can get along and work together and live together and prosper together should be noted. We could be like other countries that are blowing the hell out of themselves right now back and forth over silliness, but we don't. We don't. This country is based on friendship. And I think we should acknowledge that friendship, and I think we should move forward. And I will definitely be for this, and I will proudly say it, because I am proud North and strong here, and I am part of a community of communities. I don't care if you're black, white, or green with antennas. How dare anybody run somebody else down? It's disgusting. Well, anyway, I won't get off on a tangent, but I will be voting for this. And would anybody else like to speak? Go ahead, Anita. Go ahead, Councillor Van Henderson.
I have a little bit of trouble with my internet. Do we have to choose both options, or can we say we choose one over the other, or do we want to add something? Is that up? Do we want to do that? Do we want to recognize that we are for reconciliation? Or I found the second statement very long and confusing with the numbers of the treaties and that in there.
So through you, Your Worship, I can answer Councillor Van Henderson's question. The two statements were certainly the preferred ones of those consulted from the Saugeen Ojibwe Nation. However, they acknowledged that either of those were sufficient. Because either of those were acknowledged as sufficient and they could certainly endorse those, we developed the policy as posing those both to council. They, at the time, certainly acknowledged that the second one is a little wordy, and the first one might be better suited for an acknowledgement at the beginning of a council meeting. And it's certainly up to council of whether you want both of those in the policy, whether you want one of those in the policy. If you were to do something different, we would certainly have to go back and consult with the Saugeen Ojibwe Nation as to their thoughts on something a little different. But yeah, it's completely up to council of whether both of those are to be in the policy, acknowledging that either could be used. And then if only one is wanted to be used in the policy, then when that policy comes back to council for approval by bylaw, it could be, we would have it edited with only the preferred policy if that is the wishes of council.
Okay, thank you.
Just for my understanding, Carson, my understanding was that we could use parts or any of these if we pass this, and then that's not, I didn't understand that properly.
So to clarify, Your Worship, so there's two statements within both my staff report to council as well as within the policy. And so, for example, the policy says that either of those, either of the land acknowledgement statements for North Huron are acceptable for use by the Township of North Huron. So it is, if you leave both of them in there, it's entirely up to council or whoever it is reading the statement as to which one should be used and when it should be used. But if council wants to narrow it down to just one statement to be used across the board, we as staff can certainly bring forward a updated policy to be adopted by bylaw that just lists one approved policy to be used across North Huron.
Councillor Falker.
Thank you. Through you, Reverend. If we vote down this this proposal, are we then going to like rename Chief Wawanash's lambs in our township to represent that we just to completely eradicate that the of how we found our lands here?
Point. Go ahead, Deputy Reevesite.
So I just want to mention, we don't have a land acknowledgement now. We don't have one. If the motion were to pass, were to fail, council needs to decide whether there is to be a land acknowledgement statement at all. If there isn't, then we go ahead as normal. Like we don't have currently right now in the township of North Huron for township business any land acknowledgement statement. So to answer the question or to comment to the councilor Faulkner's question, that's a council decision. What happens when this motion fails? Or approves. It depends on what council wants. This was a request at the previous council, and it's taken this long to get to this point. So this council just needs to make a decision on whether they want the statement in or they don't want it. And if they do want it, what do they want? Do they want both or only one? And again, I'm confident that we can decide on whether if we want the land acknowledgement statement to be said, surely the chair of the meeting can decide on one of the two acknowledgements to pick which one it is. They're both acceptable to the First Nations. Why we would go and ask them for something different is beyond me when we've already asked them what we provided them for. They've come back and said these would be acknowledgement, these would accepted. So I think we just need to decide. As a council, are we accepting of a land acknowledgement? And if we are we wanting both of these or one? And if we don't want to, then that's the decision of council. I think that's as simple as this policy or this motion needs to be.
Anybody else like to speak to this? Not seeing any, we have a motion on the floor. Harrison.
Thank you, Your Worship. So the motion on the floor is that the Council of the Township of North Huron hereby receives the report of the clerk dated May 17, 2021 regarding the Indigenous Land Acknowledgement Statement and Policy for Information Purposes. And further, that Council hereby approves the Township of North Huron Indigenous Land Acknowledgement Policy as presented. And further, that Council directs the clerk to prepare a bylaw to adopt the Township of North Huron Indigenous Land Acknowledgement Policy for the June 7th, 2021 regular council meeting. So Deputy Reevesite.
Yes.
Councillor Faulkner.
Yes.
Councillor Heffer.
No.
Councillor Van Hiddersen.
Yes.
Councillor Palmer.
No.
Councillor McBurney.
Yes.
And Reeve Bailey.
Yes.
So that motion carries 5-2 with the noes being Councillor Heffer and Councillor Palmer.
Thank you kindly. Moving along, Fire Department, no reports. Recreation Community Services, no reports. Public Works and Facilities, 7.4.1, the Wingham Stand Pipe RFP outcome. That the Council of the Township of North Huron hereby receives the report from the Director of Public Works and Facilities dated May 17, 2021 regarding the Wingham Stand Pipe request for proposal outcomes for information. And further, that Council awards the engineering works for the design of a replacement elevated, Wingham Water Storage Facility to R.J. Burnside for associations at a cost of $74,002.50 for part one and $90,057.38 for part two. And further, the council appoints R.J. Burnside and Associates as project manager for the replacement of the elevated Wingham Water Storage Facility. Do I have a mover? I have Mr. Heffer moving. Do I have a seconder? I have Mr. Rick, Rick McBurney seconding. Okay, I'm going to hand that one over to, I believe, Vicki. Could you talk to us about that, or are we just moving forward?
Jamie.
If it's okay, I'll speak to it, Reeve Bailey.
My apologies.
I
was close. I got somebody to work for us.
So in 2015, RJ Burnside completed an audit on the Wickham standpipe that was originally constructed in 1974. In 1984, major reconstruction took place. In that 2015 investigation, it was determined that there was a significant amount of work that needed to be completed on the Wickham standpipe. There have been many engineering services completed on the Wickham standpipe, as well as environmental assessment process, which was completed by BM Ross, the master servicing plan, which was funded through the Clean Water and Wastewater Fund and also completed by BM Ross, to work through different elements of what would be required for the distribution system. In the 2021 budget deliberations, it was requested that $75,000 from water reserves be taken to provide an RFP for design services for the Wickham standpipe. Back in 2019, staff submitted an application for grant funding for the Canada Infrastructure Plan Green Stream Intake for the standpipe. Staff are still awaiting news to hear whether or not this will be successful. So this design work will be so that the Wickham standpipe engineering can be completed if and when the grant funding is provided, or if council determines that we would go down a different route to move forward with the work. The RFP was put out and two firms submitted their RFP proposals, BM Ross and RJ Burnside. Both consultants have worked extensively with the township and staff are very comfortable with working with either consultant. There was $75,000 put into the budget for 2021. Staff also completed a two-phased approach for the RFP. The initial phase, which would be the part one, which is the design, and part two, which is tendering and construction oversight, can be incorporated at a different date. So it also is very important to note that in the 2015 engineering report, there was no mention of imminent failure to the structure. These are all in the hopes that we will be able to obtain grant funding or move forward in a different funding mechanism for the Wickham standpipe. So I'll stop there, and if there's any questions, I'm right here.
Thank you very much, Jamie. Okay, I'm going to open it up to councilors. Is there any councilor has any questions?
I have a question, Reeve, Kevin.
Go ahead, Kevin.
Thank you. Through you, Reeve, to Jamie. In that report, you know, that you were stating that it was erected in 74, and by 84, that there was noticing problems that needed to be addressed, and I think it's been, I don't know whether lined or some work had been done on it. That's only a 10-year lifespan from new. Is there any guarantees or more design stability that we can count on? Because I know, you know, some standpipes or water towers that were erected in the 50s that, you know, they're still being used today. But this one seemed to come under criticism quite early in its lifespan. I'm just wondering if there's any way of us putting insurances on that the new structure will be a much longer duration of lifespan.
Through Reeve Bailey to Councillor Faulkner. Yes, some of the assurances that we can have are the engineering services by a licensed professional engineer. So as they're going to be overseeing the project, they will make sure that testing is completed prior, during, and after all the construction work has been put in place. So require testing or anything like that. So they will be able to assist with making sure that what's being built is going to be lasting for a decent amount of time. As well, there's different warranties and things that we can strive to place into our tender documents when available.
Thank you, Vicki. Any other questions? Go ahead, Deputy Reeve-Sight.
Yeah, the one thing I did want to mention is that it didn't say, like, reconstruction could have been for other than failure. It could have been utilization. Like, it could have been a number of other, like, I don't know anything more about why the reconstruction was done. I mean, I wasn't born yet. So, well, I was actually 5 when it was reconstructed. So I was born then. But I mean, we don't know what the reasonings were for the reconstruction. So, you know, it could have been other reasons other than just poor workmanship. I wouldn't want to say it was or it wasn't, I think. But Councillor Faulkner's points are actually granted. We need to make sure we have some assurances of what the lifespan of this thing is, knowing that we're probably looking at a bill and somewhere in the neighborhoods of, you know, a couple million bucks. So need to understand that when that price tag comes up, we need to understand what that looks like from a, you know, what is the time span, life expectancy of this particular asset? So we make sure that we're doing our things in just and make sure that we're not having an issue going forward.
We have one that was built in 1890 down by the railroad tracks and it's still standing. So if you need to borrow one for a little bit.
Okay, go ahead, Mr. Heffer.
Through you, Reeve. Thank you to Jamie. Do you know when the deadline or timeline would be when the grant would be answered? Is there any time with that at all? Thank you.
To Reeve Bailey, to Councillor Heffer. No, I'm not sure. There are two different funding. There's the provincial and the federal governments that will be provided the funding. And it's kind of in their timeline. It's all in their court. So I'm just still waiting to hear back.
Thank you. Any other questions? I am not seeing any, so I believe I have movers. So I'm going to hand it over to you, Carson.
Thank you, Your Worship. So the motion on the floor is that the Council of the Township of North Huron hereby receives the report of the Director of Public Works and Facilities dated May 17th, 2021 regarding the Wingham Standpipe request for proposal outcomes for information, and further that Council awards engineering works for the design of a replacement elevated Wingham water storage facility to RJ Burnside and Associates at a cost of $74,002.50. for part one and $90,057.38 for part two. And further that Council appoints RJ Burnside and Associates as the project manager for the replacement of the elevated Wingham water storage facility. So Councillor Faulkner?
Yes.
Councillor Heffer?
Yes.
Councillor Van Hittersen?
Yes.
Councillor Palmer?
Yes.
Councillor McBurney?
Yes.
Deputy Reeve-Sight?
Yes.
And Reeve Bailey?
Yes.
So that motion carries 7-0.
Thank you very much. We're planning for the future, ladies and gentlemen. 7.4.2 is the e-waste agreement that the Council of the Township of North Huron hereby receives the report from the Director of Public Works and Facilities dated May 17th, 2021 regarding the electric waste agreement for 2021. And further that the Council authorizes the electronic waste program to continue, and further that the Council authorizes the Township landfill site to continue as a collection site, and further that the Council directs staff to prepare an amendment to the Township's fees and charges bylaw to incorporate electronic waste fees and charges, and further that the Council directs staff to prepare a bylaw for the June 7th, 2021 regular meeting authorizing the Reeve and Clerk to sign on agreement with the Green Tech International Inc. for electronic waste collection services. Do I have a mover? I have Paul moving. I have Trevor seconding. And Jamie, did you want to speak to this one again? Is this yours?
It is. Thank you, Reeve Bailey. I don't have too much to add to this report. Currently, there is a lot of electronic waste that is diverted from our landfill and recycled by Green Tech. There's bins at the landfill site. Because of the new regulations that have come out, they are now moving towards a different type of programming and costing structure, as it's now completely borne on the producers of the products to make sure that they're going to be there's an end use or recycling component to all electronic waste, which is kind of the direction that a lot of our waste is going to be moving towards, like recycling and hazardous waste and among other things. So this is just there because it's a known place to take electronic waste at our landfill site. Staff is recommending that we continue that until more established locations are provided to residents, and then therefore given the ability for our residents to kind of have an easier location to get rid of those electronic waste, so they're not at in the ditches or ending up in our landfill. So that's really all I had to add to that.
Thank you very much, Jamie. Okay, I believe I have a mover and a seconder. Questions, comments, concerns? Not seeing any. Carson, I'll hand it over to you.
Thank you, Your Worship. So the motion on the floor is that the Council of the Township of North Huron hereby receives the report of the Director of Public Works and Facilities dated May 17, 2021 regarding an electronic waste agreement for 2021. And further, that Council authorizes the electronic waste program to continue. And further, that Council authorizes the Township's landfill site to continue as a collection site. And further, that Council directs staff to prepare an amendment to the Township's fees and charges bylaw to incorporate electronic waste fees and charges. And further, that Council directs staff to prepare a bylaw for the June 7th, 2021 regular meeting, authorizing the Reeve and Clerk to sign an agreement with Green Tech International Inc. for electronic waste collection services. So, Councillor Heffer?
Yes.
Councillor Van Hiddersen? Councillor Palmer?
Yes.
Councillor McBurney?
Yes.
Deputy Reeve Seip?
Yes.
Councillor Falconer?
Yes.
And Reeve Bailey?
Yes.
So that motion carries 7-0.
Thank you. Fire department has no reports. Building department has no reports. Child care department has no reports. CEO has no reports. Correspondence. The Huron County Library Board supports requests for the display of the flag or banner in the municipal buildings in support of Pride Month. Okay. Do I have a mover for this or conversation? Which way do you want to go with this one?
So there's no motion there, Your Worship. Ultimately it is up to council on how you want to proceed. So attached is North Huron's current Township of North Huron flag policy. So the policy, as council will see, it says no flags or banners other than federal, provincial, and municipal flags will be flown on township property. So if council was wanting to entertain this support request, in order to not contradict the policy, you would want to direct staff to bring back an amended flag policy for consideration. But ultimately, it's up to council of how you want to proceed, and we can craft a motion depending on what direction is provided by council.
First, that's exactly what I was going to say. Anyway, I'm going to open it up to council. Anybody like to talk to this? Do we want to change our policy or keep it as it's traditionally been? Go ahead, Deputy Reeve Seip.
Based on the unknown, based on my opinion, my feeling is I think we should, the flag policy is, pretty generic in the sense that if you give one aspect of it, then you're giving an aspect to everything. So, I think we've got a policy in place, and I think we should abide by that policy in this particular case.
Thank you very much. Anybody else like to speak to this? Not seeing anyone, I guess it has been said, then we shall move on. We're going to go now to, obviously council is fine with the policies, what I'm saying. So now we're going to go to council report, the Reeves activity report. I'd just like to say, unless things have changed in the last 2 days, we're going to have a couple of COVID-19 vaccination in the Westcast complex. Two of them to be held in June if everything stays on course. I believe it's for the 10th and 24th. Just so council is aware, we did reach out to Howick and to Morris Turnberry to see if we could have any volunteers from either their council or their staff come to help us run it, or volunteers from their community. They do believe and they agree with us it would be a good thing to do, because it's a long way from Howick to Goderich if for some people to get there for the vaccinations. So just want you to let that know that's going on. And also the Huron Chamber of Commerce, they have free test kits for any small businesses that want to test their employees. It's usually the bigger businesses that get involved in this. But if you were to call 519-440-0176 as a small business, you'll be able to get the kits that tell you whether you've got COVID-19 or not. I'd also like to point out that intersection in Blythe, Highway 4 and 25, will be coming up at council, county council Wednesday, and we'll be talking about it. It was a go-ahead, and then it got delayed. I think it got what I would call pieced off, so it is coming back, and I'm hoping things are going to move forward, but I will let council know as we move forward. That's about it for me today. Council member reports, verbal or written updates from members who sit on any boards. Is there anyone that would like to speak to a board they sit on? I am not seeing any hands, so we will move down to just simply comments. Is there any comments by members of the activities of our community and what's going on? Again, not seeing anyone. Notice of motion. I'm not seeing any. Nobody's put a notice of motion before. Bylaws, bylaw number 40-2021, amending agreement with Veolia Water Canada Incorporation. Do I have a mover? I have Paul Heffer moving. Do I have a seconder? I have Mr. McBurney moving. I'm having a bad time, Rick. Okay, I've got the two movers, Carson and Churchman.
Thank you, Your Worship. So the motion on the floor is that bylaw number 40-2021 being a bylaw to amend bylaw number 42-2016 being a bylaw to authorize the Reeving Clerk to sign on behalf of Council an agreement for operations, maintenance, and management services by and between the Corporation of the Township of North Huron and Veolia Water Canada Incorporated, be introduced, read a first, second, third, and final time, be signed by the Reeving Clerk, and be engrossed in the bylaw book. So, Councillor Van Hiddersom?
Yes.
Councillor Palmer?
Yes.
Councillor McBurney?
Yes.
Deputy Reeve Syke?
Yes.
Councillor Falconer?
Yes.
Councillor Heffer?
Yes.
And Reeve Bailey?
Yes.
So that motion carries 7-0.
11.2, bylaw number 41-2021, agreement with Norjohn Contracting and Paving Limited, Walker Construction Limited for the surface treatment supply and place. Do I have a mover? I have Anita Van Hiddersom moving. I have Kevin Faulkner seconding. And again, Carson, I'll give it over to you.
Thank you, Your Worship. So the motion on the floor is that bylaw number 41-2021 being a bylaw to authorize the Reeving Clerk to sign on behalf of Council an agreement between the Corporation of the Township of North Huron and Norjohn Contracting and Paving Limited, Walker Construction Limited, for the surface treatment supply in place on Moncrief Road, be introduced, read a first, second, third, and final time, be signed by the Reeving Clerk, and be engrossed in the bylaw book. So, Councillor Palmer?
Yes.
Councillor McBurney?
Yes.
Deputy Reeve Syke?
Yes.
Councillor Falconer?
Yes.
Councillor Heffer?
Yes.
Councillor Van Hiddersen?
Yes.
And Reeve Bailey?
Yes.
So that motion carries 7-0.
Thank you. Bylaw number 42-2021, Site Plan Control Agreement with the Blythe Center for the Arts. That the bylaw number 42-2021 being a bylaw to authorize a site plan control agreement between the Corporation of the Township of North Huron and the Blythe Center for the Arts. Oh, sorry. Do I have a mover and seconder? I have Kevin Faulkner moving. I have Rick McBurney seconding. Carson?
Thank you, Your Worship. So the motion on the floor is that bylaw number 42-2021 being a bylaw to authorize a site plan control agreement between the Corporation of the Township of North Huron and the Blythe Center for the Arts to permit the construction of an outdoor performance venue, theater, be introduced, read a first, second, third, and final time, be signed by the Reeve and Clerk, and be engrossed in the bylaw book. So Councillor McBurney?
Yes.
Deputy Reeve Sipe?
Yes.
Councillor Faulkner?
Yes.
Councillor Heffer?
Yes.
Councillor Van Hiddersen?
Yes.
Councillor Palmer?
Yes.
And Reeve Bailey?
Yes.
So that motion carries 7-0.
Thank you. Announcements. The next regular council meeting will be held on Monday, June 7th, 2021 at 6 p.m. through electronic participation. A special council meeting through a Housing Friendly Lens workshop will be held on Friday, May 28th, 2021 at 9 a.m. through electric participation. The next Economic Development and Recovery Committee meeting will be held on Thursday, May 20th, 2021 at 2 p.m. through electronic participation. The next Wing and BIA board meeting will be held on Thursday, May 20th, 2021 at 6:30 through electronic participation, and that was p.m. too. The next Blythe BIA board meeting will be held on Thursday, May 27, 2021 at 8 a.m. through electronic participation. The next Museum Committee meeting will be held on Thursday, June 10th, at 2021 at 2 p.m. through electronic participation. There are other business? I see none. Oh, go ahead, Trevor. Sorry. Other business? Go ahead, Trevor.
Yeah, sorry, Reeve. I was going to mention this in the comments, and I forgot, and I didn't want to get off track on your excellent reading of the bylaws, so I didn't want to get you off track there. So it's more of a comment. I'm getting more questions about, I'm getting more comments from members of the community of Wingham regarding sidewalks and the discussion of a crosswalk across Josephine Street. And I know there was some conversation with the county, and I don't know where it's landed, I guess is my question. I'm wondering if there's an update coming, if staff know of an update coming, or Reeve, do you know of any conversations at the county as it relates to that that discussion? Because I know we did ask about, I think that we did say we'd share some community discussion, but I don't know if that actually got anywhere yet. I'm just wondering if there's an update from anybody.
Yeah, I'll pick up on that. I honestly, it slipped my mind, but I just wrote it down because I've got with Jamie, I'm going to have subjects on three other issues that are part of the county will be a discussion on things I'd like to see change or we'd like to see change. So I will follow up on that in next council meeting. I will let you know. Unless Jamie has something to add to that, sorry.
I think Jamie's already left, but I didn't know whether I don't know whether council actually sent anything on. I can't remember. I couldn't recall. I couldn't look at any at the bylaws or any of the requests that wondering if council had requested staff to send something to the county. I can't recall. So just wondering if there was something that I could just reiterate that to the public that we're I have said that I think we're looking into it. It's just I couldn't give them any direction of when we did that and when there's been an update. So
Deputy Reeve Sipe, I'm going to get Dwayne Evans just to maybe I might have went down the wrong path there. So Dwayne, would you want to talk about those crosswalks? I also want to talk about the corner out in front of Tim Hortons, how you've got to jag in and out, in and out, in and out. And of course, then there's the Blythe roundabout. Do we need as council to give you directions? Do I need to write something up for a meeting or can we just have a conversation first?
Yeah, so just in terms of, I think first of all, we need to get up As Deputy Reeve has noted, we need to get updates on those projects from the county in terms of where they're at. So that at this point would be my suggestion, and then we'll bring that back to council.
Okay.
Yeah, and Reeve, that really was really the comment. If we had sent it to the county, we haven't heard back an update. I just kind of an idea of when that update might come is really where I'm looking at. Nothing more from staff. I think we had sent it to where it needed to go. I just want to make sure we get an update at some point.
And if I can elaborate on that, I don't have the motion in front of me, Reeve Bailey, but council has previously provided direction to staff and to the county that we want to be involved in those processes and the studies that are being undertaken for that intersection in particular. So at this time, it's certainly with the county, but we as staff can follow up as to that, the status of those projects.
For sure, the Blythe, as I said earlier, the Blythe roundabout or lights, whatever it's going to be, is on the county agenda for Wednesday. The rest of it we'll follow up on. Thank you, Trevor. Anyone else?
Thank you very much. Thank you, staff.
Not seeing anyone. Closed session reporting out that the Council of the Township of North Huron hereby proceeds at. Who's got a time?
7:56.
7:56. Into an in-camera session closed to the public to discuss the following. The proceeds of a pending acquisition or disposition of land by the municipality or a local board. Wingham Trailer Park Development Expressions of Interest. Do I have a mover? I have Kevin Falk moving. I have Paul Heffer seconding. Having said that, we will now go in and I will talk to you guys another time.
We have to vote on that, Your Worship.
Oh, goodness sakes, I was leaving too fast.
So you've read the motion on the floor, so I'll call the vote now. So Deputy Reeve Seif?
Yes.
Councillor Falconer?
Yes.
Councillor Heffer?
Yes.
Councillor Van Hinderson?
Yes.
Councillor Palmer?
Yep.
Councillor McBurney?
Yes.
And Reeve Bailey's declared a conflict of interest on agenda item 14. So that motion carries 6-0. So we'll end the open session meeting now and we'll move over to the closed.